So welcome, everybody. Welcome to NYU Law School. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Josh Blank. I teach here at the law school, and I'm the faculty director of the graduate tax program. We are deeply honored tonight to have with us Jason Furman from the Council of Economic Advisors at the White House. And Jason has actually been a member of our community for a while. He was a professor at the Wagner School and also a regular participant in our tax policy colloquium, which occurs during the spring semester. We could not have a better audience for you in terms of people who are interested in business tax reform and economic growth. Many of the students who are in the room tonight are either taking corporate tax or partnership tax, and some of them are taking their very first tax course. And we're also thrilled that we have so many members of our alumni community and practitioners from New York. I would just like to acknowledge we're honored to have with us your parents, Jay Furman and Gail Furman, who are with us tonight. So thank you for coming. Now I'll introduce David Kamin, who will introduce Jason. David, for those of you who have him, is an assistant professor of law here at the law school. His scholarly interests focus on the federal budget, law and economics, tax law and policy. Prior to joining us as a faculty member, he worked in the White House as special assistant to the president for economic policy. David also spent a lot of time on President Obama's first two budgets. And before I turn it over to David, I'd also like to just acknowledge David and thank David for really being the force behind this event and for making this happen. So thank you, Jason, for being here. And thank you, David. And I'll turn it over to David Kamin.
So as you no doubt know, Jason Furman is the chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors. But as you may not know, he was also twice my boss. And this means I've been lucky enough to collect a number of stories that I can now impart, perhaps with the help of Jason's parents. So Jason, now you have something to look forward to, and I'm sure you are glad that you accepted our invitation to be here. But before I get to telling tales, let me run through Jason's remarkable resume. Before assuming his current job as the president's chief economic advisor, Jason was assistant to the president for economic policy and the principal deputy director of the National Economic Council, and also my boss. From 2007 to 2008, Jason was a senior fellow in economic studies and director of the Hamilton Project at the Brookings Institute. Before joining Brookings, Jason was a visiting scholar at NYU's Wagner School and co-taught the tax policy colloquium with Dan Shaviro here at the law school. During that period, Jason also served as senior fellow at the Center on Budget and Policy Priorities, which is where I first met Jason. Among other positions he held before that, Jason during the Clinton administration served as chief economist served as a staff economist at the Council of Economic Advisors, which he now chairs, and was also special assistant to the president for economic policy. Jason also served as senior advisor to the chief economist and senior vice president of the World Bank. Jason holds a PhD in economics from Harvard, among other degrees. All right, and now we get to the fun part, the stories of a former employee. So, truth be told, I overpromised. While your parents undoubtedly have some good stories to tell, my stories will disappoint, at least in terms of entertainment value. They are tales of impeccable spreadsheets, which is a great thing in my mind, and also wise counsel. They are stories of an economist who is rigorous in his analytics and cares deeply about improving the lives of millions of Americans. Or perhaps I should just quote from the who's who set of a conservative economist writing in support of Jason's nomination as chair of the CEA. They said, "Although we differ with Jason on a number of issues, we respect him as a superb analytical economist." And if that is what those who disagree with Jason say about him, you can imagine what those who tend to agree with him think. So I am pleased to welcome back to NYU the CEA chair, Jason Furman, to speak about business tax reform and economic growth.
Thank you, David, for that introduction and not fully delivering on the promise of it. It's great to be back here at NYU. A decade ago, for a year, I co-taught the tax colloquium with Dan Shaviro. And if Dan were here today, he could judge how much I learned in the process of teaching that with him. And David was my very close partner in everything I did in the years that he was in the White House. And most of what all of us did was show up in meetings where the problems were teed up and framed by David, and he led us, and by us, me, Tim Geithner, Larry Summers, and the rest, to the answers that we were supposed to give. But we've been unguided for the last 2 years, and you can judge the consequences of that as well. I've talked a lot about tax reform over the last many years, and really welcomed this as an opportunity to bring together a set of broader thoughts about business tax reform and its role in economic growth. And I want to talk a little bit about economic growth and the context and where it comes from and what it means, and then talk much more about business tax reform and how they intersect. At the outset, I should note that the types of reforms I will be discussing will take some time to pass and implement. But some of the problems we face, most notably the recent wave of corporate inversions, are not waiting for us to resolve the bigger issues that are my focus today. That's why the president has been urging Congress to move ahead with anti-inversion legislation. And that is why today the Treasury Department announced a set of administrative actions that will, in the words of Secretary Liu, quote, make substantial progress in constraining the creative techniques used to avoid U.S. taxes, both in terms of meaningfully reducing the economic benefits of inversions after the fact, and when possible, stopping them altogether. Secretary Liu also noted that, quote, Treasury will continue to review a broad range of authorities for further anti-inversion measures as part of our continued work to close loopholes that allow some taxpayers to avoid paying their fair share. So let me start now with economic growth. And you can think of economic growth as coming from two broad sources. The first is when the economy is operating below its full potential. There's a lot of unemployment, a lot of idle factories, a lot of scarce resources. And if you can expand aggregate demand, you can create a virtuous circle, bringing back unemployment, bringing into production those scarce resources, and that will add to the economy's growth. That was exactly the situation we found ourselves in when we came into office. By October of 2009, the unemployment rate had risen to 10%. The number of people working part-time was very elevated, and the participation rate had fallen sharply. Since that time, there's been a substantial amount of economic progress. The unemployment rate had been falling at a rate of about 0.7 percentage point per year. That's now accelerated to 1.1% per year. The increased pickup in the pace of job growth has also stabilized the unemployment rate, resulted in a pattern of job creation that's 100% full-time jobs, and is now 54 months into a consecutive streak of private sector job growth that exceeds anything that's come before in this country. We have a lot of challenges in our labor market, many of which stem from problems that were mounting in the run-up to the crisis. Participation, low levels of labor force fluidity, part-time work, and an increase in long-term unemployed. We still need to deal with all of those, but if you look at where we are in the business cycle now, the unemployment rate is about 80% of the way back to where it was prior to the crisis, and that's true even if you include people who are discouraged workers or what are so-called marginally attached workers. What that says is there's some more scope for recovery, there's some more scope for aggregate demand, but going forward, the much more important driver of growth, the one that we're most focused on, and the one that is important in the context of business tax reform, is the second source of growth, which is expanding the potential of the economy. And the potential of the economy is determined by three things. It's determined by the amount of labor you have, it's determined by the amount of capital you have, and it's determined by something called total factor productivity, the ways in which you combine capital and labor to form output. I'm not going to have a lot to say about labor. A lot of it's exogenous, things like the retirement of the baby boom generation. Some of it depends on policies like immigration and what we do about workplace policies that affect female labor force participation. But I want to talk about the other two, productivity, and in particular, about productivity growth. You can break productivity growth itself down into three things. The first is the quality of the labor that goes into it, how much education, training, and skills. The second is the amount of capital, and the third is technology, TFP, which I was talking about before. If you look at what's happened in productivity growth in the last couple decades, you see three important things, which you can see in this chart. The first is, and you see this in the bar at the far right, that productivity growth has increased at an average rate of 2.2% a year. When you accumulate that over 60 years, it means that a worker today can produce four times more than someone 60 years ago. And if you look then at the colored bars, half of the reason they can produce more is that we have more TFP, better technology, better organization, larger scales of markets. 40% of it is because a worker today has more equipment at their disposal. And only about 10% of it is better training and education. The second thing you see from these set of bars is that productivity growth rates vary quite a lot over long periods of time. They were very strong in the 50s and 60s, in part because a lot of the inventions from World War II were being commercialized, in part because of things like the interstate highway system. It fell quite a lot in the 70s and 80s, partly in response to the oil shocks. And then with the new economy, starting in 1995, it started growing again. But the thing that's particularly important in looking at those three periods, and that's going to link to a lot of the ways in which I think about business tax reform and economic growth, is the reason those three are different isn't the green or the orange. It isn't the education or the amount of capital. It's the total factor productivity. And that is varied by not just the most important thing in growth, but it's the thing that varies the most. And that's going to be important because, just to preview it, a lot of my theme about business tax reform is going to be that it's about the quality of investment, not the quantity of investment. The reason the quantity of investment hasn't been a particularly exciting part of the variations in economic growth over the last 60 years is that investment as a share of GDP hasn't varied a whole lot in the last 60 years, generally bouncing between 10% and 14% of GDP. There is a big debate over the future of economic growth. You may have paid attention to people like Robert Gordon, or if you're economics aficionados, people like Bob Hall or John Fernald, who have been pessimistic about the outlook for productivity growth and for US economic growth. There's people on the other side, like mega optimists, Eric Brynjolfsson, and people that are optimistic but not quite, like Ben Bernanke. And if you listen to their debate, they have fierce arguments over how much the economy will grow. Their debates are partly what's going to happen to labor with things like participation rates, but their debates are almost entirely about total factor productivity growth. No one's debating, are we going to invest a lot or invest a little, as their way to understand the future of economic growth. This now brings me to business tax reform and the three ways in which it can affect the economy. The first, which is the traditional way of thinking about business tax reform, is in the context of what it does to the cost of capital and what the cost of capital does to the quantity of investment over the long run. Tons and tons and tons of papers have been written on this topic. And the general finding has been, when you do growth models where you try to quantify business tax reform plans, you tend to find, whether it's an overlapping generations model, an infant horizon model, or whatever other model, you tend to find the effects are relatively small when measured this way. And the reason is because the business tax reforms, the types I'm going to be talking about, are revenue neutral. And when you have revenue neutral reform, you're not, on balance, changing the level of taxation of capital. You're just reorganizing it. And that means, with certain important caveats I'll discuss later, you're not dramatically changing the cost of capital, which means you're not dramatically changing the quantity of investment, which means you're not changing the level or growth of output. I should add as an aside that to the degree you're talking about revenue losing tax reform, you can dramatically lower the cost of capital, which would boost investment. But at the same time, you also increase the deficit, which reduces national savings and reduces investment. And the net effect of the two of those is more likely, my judgment, to be negative than positive. So I don't think the cost of capital and the quantity of investment, I think it's an important issue, but I don't think it's the most important issue in thinking about why we care about business tax reform and economic growth. As a longer aside, the one big important footnoted exception to the statement I'd make is when we're thinking about the short run. And when we're thinking about the short run, we're thinking about aggregate demand. And when we're thinking about that, I think the cost of capital can have a big effect. And my example there would be that in dealing with the recession, we enacted bonus depreciation, which lets you depreciate more upfront. In 2011, for a year that was expensing, which was that your idea, David? I think it might have been David's idea, or an idea that he convinced me that I had. Can't remember which. We had 100% expensing in 2011. And policies like this, in a time of financial crisis and constrained aggregate demand, I think can have a potentially large impact. And that's because the way bonus depreciation works is a company gets a lot of money in the first year, and then it pays that money back because it doesn't get to use those depreciation allowances in the future. If you're credit constrained and unable to borrow, getting $50 billion, which is the amount that an aggregate went out in the first year, can actually make a big difference for your investment. The cost to the federal government isn't $50 billion, it's just the present value lost to the fisc from extending what is in effect an interest-free loan. And as a result, you only need small amounts of additional incremental investment out of that $50 billion upfront in order to have a very large multiplier. And indeed, recent research by Eric Zwick and James Mahan found precisely that in the Great Recession, bonus depreciation had a big impact on output, and it had an even bigger impact for firms that were capital constrained. In a sense, for them, you could think of it as lowering the cost of capital from infinity, because they're unable to borrow, down to effectively zero, because it's an interest-free loan. Similar logic applies to things like net operating loss carrybacks, which was something we did, which shouldn't affect the cost of capital at all in a standard model. But again, if you're unable to borrow, you get more cash now, less cash later. That can lead you to increase your investment. This analysis, though, is very much limited to times when you're trying to expand aggregate demand because you're in a recession, to times when you're credit constrained. I think at the point we're in now, we're less focused on aggregate demand and more on the long run. Capital markets are functioning much better. And as a result, the benefits associated with bonus depreciation are considerably smaller than they were when it was first passed. The cost, in terms of the potential that it becomes a permanent unpaid for extender, is much larger. And as a result, the president has not supported continuing to extend bonus depreciation. Let me now return back to the long run and where I think business tax reform is most important. And as I said, I think that is something that I'll shorthand as improving the quality of investment, which is something that goes into TFP. Now, I should be very clear, the quality of investment isn't a big fancy machine that's really expensive. That actually shows up in the quantity of investment, because we measure quantity basically by how much you're paying for things. What I mean by the quality of investment is, for example, where you allocate your capital, allocating it to higher return areas of the economy instead of lower returns, how you distribute your production capacity globally in the United States and abroad, and how you're dealing with things like externalities in areas like research and development. This perspective on the quality of capital has three important implications for what I'll call the fundamental underpinnings of business tax reform. The first is that in general, the tax system should strive for neutrality. And what I mean by neutrality is that business decisions are being made for business reasons, maximizing what, with an important exception I'll get to in a moment, is the social benefits associated with that investment, not maximizing something that was just determined by arbitrary variations in the tax system. Neutrality is an appealing concept to begin a discussion about business tax reform with, or any tax reform for that matter, because it's a little bit less loaded than what the tax rate should be, what the revenue level should be, whether or not you want a consumption tax, whether you want a tax capital, any of those types of concepts. No matter what your view on any of those questions, you should be able to agree that conditional on any resolution of all of those debates, more neutrality is in general better than less. I say in general because the second fundamental underpinning is an exception, which is in carefully delineated specific cases, the tax system should deviate from neutrality to correct externalities. And I'll come back to that when I get to the president's plan. And then the final one, which is on pretty much everyone's list for tax reform, for good reason, is that the tax system should be simpler. I think we need some humility about our ability to simplify business tax reform, the business tax system, when much of the complication in business taxes doesn't stem from distortions, loopholes, and tax expenditures, but just from the real difficulty of measuring income itself. And a lot of that complexity is impossible to eliminate, but we could certainly do a better job on it than we're doing now. So with these concepts in hand, I want to now look at how the US tax system does. And I want to look at it to some degree judged against these principles, especially the principle of neutrality. And I want to look at it in the context of other countries. It's really common in economic policy to talk about how our education or our research or our housing system compares to that in other countries. I do that myself, but generally it's a motivation for acting. Maybe you can learn a lesson from another country, but there's nothing about the way the US education system should run that's a function of how China, Korea, or Singapore run their education systems. Here it's different. Our tax system is part of a global economy. Businesses are deciding about where to locate capital and production around the world. So the comparison to the rest of the world is both interesting in terms of lessons, but also directly relevant, and in fact is relevant to one of the neutrality concepts I'll be talking about. So to start with that comparison to the rest of the world, I think you've probably all seen this graph, but it's still striking. In 1981, we had basically the same tax rate as the OECD weighted average, excluding the United States. We then cut our tax rate, our corporate tax rate, in 1986 from 50 down to 34. And the rest of the OECD moved sort of more gradually in fits and starts, different countries at different times, but they matched us and now have an average tax rate that is well below that in the United States, an average statutory tax rate, of course. As a result of that, the United States now has the highest statutory income tax rate in the entire world, with the exception of certain investments in, I think, the UAE or some country somewhere in the world that if you don't know what you're doing, you can end up with paying more than our tax rate. The high statutory tax rate isn't matched by a commensurately high effective tax rate. And that's because in a lot of important ways, the corporate tax base in the United States is substantially narrower than the tax base in many other countries. And that too has evolved over time, and it's evolved in the opposite direction as the rates. You can see these are estimates of the present discounted value of depreciation allowances. Unfortunately, these data haven't been updated, so you don't see what happened in the context of the Great Recession. But basically, as part of lowering the tax rate in 1986, the present value of depreciation was reduced in the United States. But then we've basically kept it flat, except in recessions when we make it more generous. The rest of the G7 has tightened up on depreciation rules, reducing the present value of depreciation from 82 to below 75%, and has used that in part to pay for the rate reductions that they phased in over the period I'm showing you now. As a result, when you compare the effective marginal tax rate in the United States to other G7 countries, we're basically right in the, well, literally in the middle of the pack and slightly lower than a weighted average. I should note this is 2011, so it doesn't incorporate the rate reductions in Japan that were continued to be phased in over the following 2 years. There's also a lot of complexities and debates around how to account for things like value-added taxes and sales taxes in here. But no matter how you look at it, the broad conclusion holds that the issue in the United States isn't that we're overtaxing. The issue is that we're poorly taxing, and poorly taxing in the form of a high statutory rate. Even if you didn't have this international comparison and were just looking purely at the United States, you'd see a number of important deviations from neutrality. And I'll go through four of them. The first is the US tax system distorts investment by industry. These are Treasury estimates, and they range from an effective federal corporate tax rate of 14% on utilities to 31% for construction, wholesale, and retail trade. It's these types of tax rates that lead to a concern that investment could be allocated in part based on the highest after-tax rate of return, which is not the same as the highest pre-tax rate of return, and thus could be misallocated. A lot of what's, you know, part of what's causing this is specific, you know, more egregious loopholes. Oil and gas is the one of the most notable ones. But a lot of what's causing this is just issues in, for example, the way depreciation schedules operate. The second departure from neutrality is that the US tax system distorts investment financing by giving an especially strong preference to debt. If you look just at corporate taxes only, which is on the left side here, we have an effective marginal tax rate on investments in equipment when financed by equity of 37%. That's actually average for the OECD. And we have a tax rate of minus 60%, which is the when it's financed by debt, which is the lowest of anywhere in the OECD. And the gap between those is larger than any other country. That's a little bit of an unfair way to look at it, because you really want to look at an integrated basis and include individual level taxes, because interest is taxed more heavily than dividends, although interest isn't fully taxed because a lot of it is earned by tax exempt. So when you include the individual level, the marginal tax rate on equity is still 37. On debt, it's still negative at minus 4. And this is the consequence of a tax system that has a combination of accelerated depreciation and the full deductibility of interest, and then the features associated with the taxation at the individual level that I referenced. The consequences of this is it can lead to over-leveraging, and over-leveraging in turn leads to financial fragility. In a downturn, equity can provide cushion, but debt does not. That can lead to fire sales, contagions, and all of that can exacerbate macroeconomic fluctuations, and I think played a role in the financial fragility of the economy in the recession that we just went through. The third way in which the tax system deviates from neutrality is in the form of businesses, and in particular by disfavoring large C corporations. You don't see this if you just look at the statutory tax rates, which is 35% for corporate and 39.6 top rate for pass-throughs. But corporate income, of course, is partially taxed at two levels. It's partially taxed at the corporate level, and it's partially taxed again at the individual level. Pass-through is only taxed once. And so when you look at tax rates on an integrated basis, you see a 9 percentage point advantage when using the unrounded numbers for corporate form over pass-throughs. And that, again, leads to distortions that have mounted over time. If you look at the share of C corporation in total business receipts, they've fallen from 85% in 1980 to about 60% now, in part because of the reasons we're talking about. Now, I want to be very clear. When it comes to small businesses, there's a set of other considerations, and I'll talk about how the president's framework cut and simplifies taxes for them. But when it comes to large pass-throughs that are, to all intents and purposes, acting an awful lot like a C-corp, you'd like that decision to be made for economic, substantive, business organizational reasons, not because the tax system tilts you in that direction. The final violation of neutrality in our tax system is the most complicated. And it's the most complicated because there's competing factors that go in different directions. And this is the way the tax system treats international income. On the one hand, there's a neutrality concept that centers around capital export neutrality. And that says we have a given amount of capital, and we're going to choose where to locate it. Are we going to parachute the factory into the United States or send it abroad? To have that type of neutrality, we'd like the same tax rates in the United States and abroad. So you'd go wherever you have the highest pre- and after-tax rate of returns. And to get to that, you would need a pure worldwide tax system where you tax U.S. source income, U.S.-based income, no matter where it's earned anywhere in the world. Going the other direction, however, is capital ownership neutrality. And that envisions a world where instead of the quantity of capital we have to allocate being fixed, it pictures a world where the United States has an elastic amount of capital. We can allocate as much as we have productive projects to allocate them to. But what is fixed is where the location of production is. There's a factory already in China, another factory in Malaysia, another factory in Brazil. And the question is not will that factory be making stuff in China, but will it be the subsidiary of a US corporation, or will it be a subsidiary of a French corporation? What capital ownership neutrality says is there may be substantial differences in productivity, whether that corporation is, whether that factory is a sub of a US company or a French company. And you want that decision, again, to be made for efficiency reasons, not for tax reasons. And the way to make sure that that happens is to have a pure territorial system where no one's paying taxes to their home country. Everyone's paying taxes to China or Malaysia. And as a result, whoever has the highest return locates there. Such a pure territorial system would, of course, greatly exacerbate the capital export neutrality. It would give a big tax incentive to locate new production overseas. And perhaps even more concerning is it would exacerbate the third non-neutrality I want to talk about, which is base erosion. And base erosion isn't subject to the, on the one hand, on the other hand, it's unambiguously a problem. Because when US corporations can take the profits that are earned in the United States but use interest stripping or transfer pricing or other techniques to shift those profits out of the United States, the result of that is, for a given amount of revenue, a higher tax rate and a higher tax rate on U.S. businesses operating in the United States. Such profit shifting is an enormous part of the international system. We put this chart in the president's framework for business tax reform a couple of years ago, but updating the numbers from 2005 to 2010, they've gotten so mind-bogglingly large that we had to check it three times. So Bermuda, that is 1,578% of Bermuda's GDP is the profits that U.S.-controlled foreign corporations report in Bermuda. I don't know if I've ever been there, but I don't get the sense it's filled with enormous amounts of production. You don't notice them here because they're so small compared to Bermuda, the British Virgin Islands and the Cayman Islands. But even at 13% for Cyprus, 38% for Ireland, or 15% for the Netherlands, those are really large numbers of an amount of their GDP that is profits reported by U.S. companies domiciled there. There is a lot of production in those places. Ireland is an attractive place to invest as a gateway to Europe with a well-trained workforce. But it's hard to believe that that 38% of GDP is entirely because of what I was calling neutrality, business decisions being made for business reasons without regard to the tax system. If you look all in at our international tax system, Roseanne Altshuler and Harry Grubert did a set of simulations, and they found that a standard tax rate for a U.S. multinational located in a low-tax country was minus 25%. And for a U.S. multinational located in a high-tax country, they defined that as a 25% rate, was 13%. And that's really remarkable, because we think of a worldwide system as 35%, no matter where you are. We think as a territorial system, as the United States isn't taxing you, so you're going to have to pay the taxes in the country you're in. But as I just said, in a low-tax country, you pay minus 25. In a high-tax country, the 25% rate, you pay 13%. So this isn't what is often not close to a worldwide system that some people say the United States has. It's not even a territorial system. It's what I like to call a stupid territorial system. And it's a stupid territorial system because it has lower tax revenues than even a territorial system, and that's because of the mismatch. You get all the benefits of pretending that you're taxed in the form of the interest deductions without the cost of actually having to pay the taxes if you defer the income. And as a result, you get the distortions associated with the tax in terms of, for example, capital lockout, but you don't get any of the revenue that you want with a tax system. And, you know, the tax code in general, you can debate, do you want sort of trade-offs of revenue versus distortions, but the idea of lots of distortions with no revenue is certainly a system that can be improved on. So let me now briefly outline the framework the president put forward to deal with business tax reform that really is very much grounded in exactly the concepts that I've been going through with you. It's something he originally called for in his State of the Union address in the beginning of 2011. And then we put out the framework in February of 2012. It's called the President's Framework for Business Tax Reform, and every word in that title is important. The president is, well, the president's important for a lot of reasons. But the fact that he's in the title means this isn't some academic study that came out of the Treasury Department with three different models and lots of footnotes. It's something that reflects about a dozen meetings with the president, both before and after his call in the State of the Union. Framework is important because it's not a fully specified legislative language, but it's not a set of principles either. It's a reasonably fleshed out approach. I think it totals 22 pages, and it would have been longer if David hadn't done it in 11-point font. And finally, it's called business tax reform, not corporate tax reform. And that's because I think we can address the business system as a whole without addressing the full tax system. I don't think you can address just the corporate and the C-corporate system alone, because you want to avoid the issue of broadening the tax base on all businesses and then plowing all that money back into tax cuts for C-corporations, which would leave small businesses with a tax cut. So we take an integrated approach that looks at businesses small and large, looks at C-corps and pass-throughs. There are five elements of that proposal. The first is cutting the corporate rate to 28%. Part of that's paid for by closing loopholes like the oil and gas ones that I was describing before. But the fact is you add up all the loopholes you can possibly think of and you don't come close to paying for a 28% rate, which is why you need some structural reforms as well. And in particular, you need some combination of the following three. Addressing accelerated depreciation, addressing the deductibility of interest, and addressing the way income is taxed at the for large pass-throughs. If you do any real combination of those three plus close the loopholes, you're going to do a lot better, or you're going to do better, on all the neutralities that I described. You'll have less varying tax rates for different industries. You'll cut the wedge between debt and equity. You'll cut the wedge between C-corps and pass-throughs. And a lower tax rate means that trade-off between worldwide and territorial that I was talking about before in terms of capital export neutrality and capital ownership neutrality is less severe and problematic. The second thing is making permanent expanding and reforming key incentives. And this follows from the second fundamental underpinning I was talking about before. And the framework singled out three examples of this. The R&E credit, because the social returns to innovation are about twice as large as the private returns, and as a result, businesses will invest too little in innovation. That's why we expand the R&E credit and make it permanent. The second is tax credits for clean energy, like the production tax credit for wind. And that's because we have an externality associated with carbon emissions, and that is partly addressed by subsidizing areas like wind. And the third is expanding the tax deduction for manufacturing, Section 199, in a way that brings the corporate rate for manufacturers down to 25%. And the administration's rationale for that is spillovers in manufacturing and innovation in manufacturing. You can debate any one of these three, whether it should or shouldn't be on the list. You could debate whether we should add things to the list, but that debate should be structured around what are the externalities, what are the broader economy-wide spillovers, not, you know, we like this or don't like that. The third part of the system is establishing a hybrid international system with a minimum tax on the earnings of foreign subsidiaries. This is, as I said, it's sort of hard to not improve on the current international system in the context of tax reform. Our approach takes a midpoint. It's one that takes base erosion very seriously, and I think we'll do a better job in preventing it and making sure that we're keeping some of that revenue here. It does a better job leveling the playing field so you wouldn't locate overseas for tax reasons. But I think we can also do that while being better at ensuring that our businesses are globally competitive and located wherever they are in the world for economic reasons to serve local markets or have efficient supply chains. The fourth area is simplifying and reducing taxes for small businesses. This is something that the president thinks is very important. It's part of why, as I said, it's business tax reform, not just corporate tax reform. And we can do this through things like expanding Section 179 expensing, expanding cash accounting, and are open to other ideas. One idea we're not open to, which I'll come back to, is lowering the top individual rate, because that is extremely expensive and inefficient in serving this purpose. And then finally, the president's framework, I guess an amendment to the framework a year later, after David left, improved it, would be to fund immediate investments in infrastructure. That's because when you transition to a new corporate tax system, there's some one-time money that you raise in the course of that transition. You wouldn't want to put that one-time money into permanent rate reductions, because then you'd find yourself with deficits in the out years. The president's proposed to put it into infrastructure. And I would note the Republican chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee, Dave Camp, adopted that same proposal. At the same time, it's really important to be revenue neutral over the medium and long run. These immediate investments actually help that, not hurt that. But what's also important is guarding against things like timing shifts. Depreciation changes, for example, can accelerate revenue into the window, leaving you with what looks like balance over the 10 years, but then you're adding to the deficit beyond the 10-year window at a time when we're most concerned about our overall deficits and debts. So I want to talk now about four sets of objections to this framework, and in particular to the focus on tax rates. And many of these objections are ones that I used to hear in Dan Shaviro's seminar. Some of them were ones I used to hear from Dan Shaviro and have been waiting for a microphone so I could adequately answer all of them. I should say, I don't think there's any one person that's made all four of these objections, but there's certainly some that have made more than one. The first is the traditional economist view, which is that tax rate reductions are a windfall for old capital. And the basic concept here is if you lower the tax rate, you get a lower tax rate on all the investments you've already made and the returns you get from them in the future. And you have a lower tax rate on all the new investments that you make in the future. The problem is then if you pay for it in a way that only raises taxes on new investments, on net you've cut taxes for old investments and you've raised taxes for new investments. And the problem with cutting taxes for old investments is, first of all, it's a little bit unfair. But second of all, you're not going to make any more investments 10 years ago just because you retroactively cut the tax rate on investments that were made 10 years ago. So it's economically inefficient as well. I think this is an objection that one, or consideration that one should take very seriously. But I think it doesn't understand ways in which the modern economy has changed that I think tilt the playing field towards the importance of lowering tax rates. The first of those is that the framework I just did is someone who's considering an increment to capital, a marginal change in their investment, adding an extra machine to a factory. That's not what most business decisions that we're concerned about are. Most of them are where to locate a factory, whether to locate it here or abroad, where to locate production or some other form of economic activity. Moreover, that traditional approach is all about the normal returns that you'd get, whereas, again, a lot of what we're interested in is supernormal returns, things or returns to things that aren't part of the investment that you would get to depreciate to intangibles. And a lot of the strength we'd like in the U.S. economy would come from attracting, developing, and having the U.S. be a location for those types of large investments, those types of investments with supernormal returns. And those respond to the average tax rate and depend, when you lower the average, when you lower the tax rate, statutory tax rate, you lower the average tax rate and you get more of this type of activity. The second is that many of the non-neutralities I discussed are reduced in a world where you're cutting tax rates. And that's particularly true for the international non-neutralities, the competition between capital export neutrality and capital ownership neutrality. If you have a lower rate, that's a less severe problem, and there's no other way to fully satisfy both of those concerns. The third issue for rates is one that I'm not sure about, but I think is worth thinking about. And every business person and tax practitioner always says that what they look at is earnings per share, not their cash flow, and that more generous depreciation doesn't improve their earnings per share. As a result, their CEOs don't care about it. The tax rate does, and that the tax rate is especially salient, maybe psychologically above and beyond that. It's a little bit hard for me to imagine that that large a violation of sort of the basic economics of the cost of capital happens, but you hear it enough that I think it's worth worrying about. The new economist's view, although there are a certain number of old economists that had it, is that the corporate tax rate should actually be zero. And you hear this from Greg Mankiw, Eric Toder, and Alan Viard. Larry Kudlow seems to be obsessed with this notion, if you want to really, well, cast some doubt on it. And there's a few issues with this. The first is that we raise $315 billion a year from corporate taxes. Now, some people describe $315 billion as 1.8% of GDP and say that's small. Just to give you a sense of the scale of that, our entire present value of our deficits over the next 75 years that everyone is so worried about are about 1.9% of GDP. So this is large relative to most of the deficit problems people are talking about. Moreover, if you just willy-nilly lowered the corporate rate to zero, you'd lose a lot more than $315 billion. You'd lose a lot of income that's currently collected from the individual tax code, as individuals recharacterize that as untaxed business income and allowed their income to grow inside their untaxed businesses. There's a slightly more sophisticated version of this, which says businesses are mobile. Individuals are much less mobile, so let's tax the individuals, not tax the businesses. I think there's some merit to that, and I think there's some aspect in which that should be considered and factored in, and that's part of why all the revenue raising the president's proposing comes from the individual side, not from the business side. But it too runs into a set of practical objections. If you tax capital gains and dividends at the full individual rate, maximum rate of 39.6, that would be enough to cut the corporate tax rate by somewhere between 1 and 2 percentage points. So get us all the way from 35 to 34 or 33, a far cry from making up for the elimination of it. Even if you do the more sophisticated things that Eric Toder and Alan Viard have proposed, which is taxing capital gains at accrual, you still only raise enough revenue to pay for half of the cost of eliminating the corporate tax. And then there's a whole nother set of issues that I won't even get into, involving a lot of corporate income ends up flowing through to untaxed entities like pension funds and foundations. So you'd still need some type of withholding tax, or that income would never be taxed anywhere. The third issue is what I'll call the conservative view, which is that the top individual rate needs to be cut with the corporate rate. And this is embodied, for example, in last year's budget resolution passed by the House of Representatives, called for a top individual rate of 25% and a top corporate rate of 20%. And you hear over and over again, small businesses shouldn't have to pay more than big corporations. That format of the argument has almost no merit, which I'll get to. There's a little bit of merit to this, which is whenever you have different tax rates, statutory tax rates, there's room for income shifting. There's additional complexity. You need to write rules to prevent that from happening. So there's something to this, but I don't think there's a lot. The reason why there's not a lot is, again, that integrated tax rate we were looking at before. The corporate income is partially taxed twice. The individual income is only taxed once. The combination means that corporate income is actually taxed more heavily now than large pass-through income. So we don't need to cut both rates. Cutting both rates will mean that we're keeping that problem the same, not shrinking the magnitude of the problem. There's also a very serious practical objection to doing this. And that practical objection is the fact that cutting the top individual rate costs $5 trillion over 10 years. And if you got rid of every single tax preference or benefit for high-income households, you wouldn't raise $5 trillion over 10 years. That means you'd be left either adding to the deficit or raising taxes on middle-class households in order to pay for tax cuts for high-income households, a formula that doesn't work. And in fact, I would speculate that it was precisely this arithmetic that led Dave Camp, who, when he started out trying to get 25 and 25, ending up with a plan that had 25 for corporate and 25 plus 10 for individual. He nowhere in his documents added the two of those numbers up, so I leave that as an exercise to all of you. The last objection is the progressive view. And the progressive view is that we have substantial needs for investment in this country. We have a need over the medium and long run to cut the deficit, and it's important that we do that in a balanced manner. And so why would we want to take all these corporate loopholes, many of which were devised by corporations to start with, and take all the money from it and put it back into funding tax rate reductions? I have, and Lee has, a considerable amount of sympathy with that perspective. I think it's important to understand, though, that first of all, the president's framework does put a lot of money into infrastructure investment. The president's framework would reduce the long run deficit relative to a potentially realistic counterfactual by paying for all the tax extenders. And finally, I'd note that if you look at something like Dave Camp's plan, for example, his single biggest tax raiser is shifting to economic depreciation that raises $270 billion over 10 years. There's no way, no one on the progressive side, no one on any side that would advocate doing that purely to pay for something else or for deficit reduction. It doesn't have the feel of a loophole. It has the feel much more of something that is available as a pay for a lower tax rate would not be available for something else. So want to conclude by just putting this discussion we've been having about business tax reform in a little bit of a broader context. You know, business tax reform can increase the quality of our investment in capital. It can potentially have some increase in the quantity of that investment as well. And as a result, it can increase our labor productivity, our level of output, and spread out over time, our growth rate as well. It's only part of the agenda. And it's important that when we're pursuing business tax reform, first of all, that we're not doing harm to other things that matter too. And the chief risk there would be doing harm to the medium and long run deficit. And while we're doing business tax reform, we should be looking for opportunities to make other things better. And one of the problems we have in our country is an infrastructure deficit. And we've structured business tax reform to increase our investments in infrastructure. Beyond it, a lot of other things are critical to our economic growth: immigration reform, education, housing, the economic integration with Europe, Asia, and the rest of the world. And they're important too. And finally, none of this will guarantee that the benefits of growth translate into income for the typical family. And that's why taking addition, I think growth is always going to put you in a better position to help, but it certainly isn't sufficient. And that's why steps like raising the federal minimum wage, expanding the earned income tax credit, especially for parents and non-custodial children, and reforms to workplace flexibility, paid leave, and measures like that that could increase participation in the workforce matter so much as well. And I want to thank you for your attention on the topic of business tax reform. And we have a bunch of time for questions where I'm happy to deal with any of these other issues as well, if they're on your mind. Thank you. And it may feel like this to some of you. I started speaking at 8 a.m. this morning, so I'm going to sit down for the questions and answers.
All right. So, And I should say, for those asking questions, please state your name, also your affiliation.
Okay. David Miller, Kevlar. I'm also an adjunct at NYU.
Wait, I'm sorry, can you say that again? I was
David Miller. I'm a tax lawyer at Cadwallader. I'm also an adjunct here at NYU. So Warren Buffett will die in a few years, and will never have paid any income tax on his Berkshire Hathaway stock. And he's not the only one. I sort of wonder, why not use something like a mark-to-market system of taxation, if not to eliminate the corporate income tax for publicly traded companies, but to reduce it? Mm-hmm. And why, you know, more broadly, do we leave that money on the table?
Mm-hmm. So first of all, I think you're addressing an important issue, which is that capital gains taxation taxes and dividend taxes have a large voluntary element to them, and we tend not to do as well when we ask people to volunteer to pay taxes than when we compel them to. And it means that those, especially capital gains realizations, become very sensitive to tax rates. And that's precisely why, if you don't address the issue you're talking about, cutting capital gains, raising capital gains and dividends rates can only pay for such a small reduction in the corporate rate. I think there is an interesting academic discussion to be had about what you're addressing. I think it raises an issue that sometimes is underappreciated. There's a lot of progressives that want to raise the capital gains rate to ordinary income, The revenue maximizing rate is probably in the 28 to 30, so you'd actually lose money if you raised it to 39.6 according to the official scores. And that's precisely because the rate isn't getting at this issue, which is the issue of accrual. So I think that's a worthwhile issue for people to discuss and think about. It's not going to get you to a corporate tax rate of zero. As I said, it would pay for about half of it in according to the Toter and Viard estimates. I find sometimes the JCT is more pessimistic than people are in doing revenue estimates for their own plans. But
but we leave the money on the table now. And you talk about income inequality, and there's perhaps not that much that the tax system can do about income inequality, but this is sort of low-hanging fruit, right? You could reduce it by a third at the at the upper levels.
I think it is something that a great topic for people here to keep working on.
Hi, Andrew Bond with Millennium Management. We're investors. The Treasury Department came out today with its long-awaited inversion regulations. So the first question is that it seems like the bulk of the changes are really meant to target earnings and cash that has been built up in CFCs by U.S. companies over time, and to make sure that those earnings that have deferred taxes attached to them will always be paid at some point. Do the regulations, are they also intended to make sure that those current CFCs in the future will also be always subject to a deferred tax? So I'm trying to understand if it's really just about the existing cash that's mm-hmm. been trapped and making sure that that gets paid eventually in the future.
Yeah, these are the new steps. And by the way, as the press release said, the first steps, and Treasury is still continuing to consider additional steps in this area, were announced right before we started talking. And I would like to leave for today the Treasury to be addressing any of the technical issues associated with that.
Okay, no, that's fair enough. And then maybe just a quick follow-up is that the regulations seemed like it came out as only proposed regulations as opposed to a proposed notice and temporary regulation?
Right. Yeah, Damian Paletta tweeted last week that the fact that this speech was scheduled for 6:30 p.m. on Monday meant that we were putting out our inversions announcement at 6:30 p.m. Monday. He coincidentally happened to have been right, but David asked me to do this months ago as an opportunity to talk to the broader issue. So I appreciate how important that is, but would rather the Treasury be the one to speak to it today. Hey, Lee.
Hi there. So put that back up, your industry distortions there about, some industries pay more than average and the effective tax rates on industries. Okay. So if you look at who's paying the most, right, it's finance and then it's various kinds of services and retail, right?
Yep.
And they can't leave. Because those are, a lot of them are people things that you have to do here. And I'm not dragging up inversions. And,
I'm not sure how mobile utilities and mining are.
Well, no, but they're, no. I'm talking about the ones at the right end.
Sorry,
no, but, well, utilities are utilities. They never paid any taxes. you have to look at this as the broad historical sweep. But are you sure that you want, more investment in those things when we already have a lot of investment in those things? And those are not, when you think about it, very productive industries. I think my question is, and you see this a lot in the CAMP plan too, and you see this in the choice of corporate goodies that you want to repeal, because they're not really loopholes there, like you said, benefits we all agreed on, like accelerated depreciation. If you look at the corporate tax in that way, you see basically a bunch of benefits with a tax attached, right? Our base is really narrow, and we have all this signaling. Oh, manufacture in the United States, buy depreciable machinery, do your R&D here, blah, 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 right? So are you sure you want to turn yourself inside out to cut the taxes for, you know, that right side of the table there when, you know, when you're right of manufacturing there? Those are not very productive industries, and, you know, why do you want to sort of, as a signaling matter, encourage those?
So the next time I do this, I think I need to add a fifth thing, which are the very intelligent and important points that Lee Shepard always raises about every tax issue. I would say a few things. One is that's partly why, partly the rationale for expanding 199 as part of the reform, and that leaves you with a manufacturing rate of 25 instead of 28, is in part because of the global competitiveness and location considerations that you have there that you don't have in some of the others. It's partly a rationale for something that I neglected to talk about, probably should have, which is I think there is, especially with large financial firms, a negative externality associated with the risk they impose on the economy. And Dodd-Frank has ended the, you know, has ended too big to fail, has ended taxpayer finance bailouts. But even it hasn't ended the possibility that a bank would cause something like we saw in 2007 and the associated costs in unemployment insurance, food stamps, and lost revenue. And so that type of fiscal externality, I think, is a rationale for we have a financial crisis responsibility fee, and I can't remember what Camp calls it, a bank tax. So, you know, in some senses, maybe the mistake was mine in overstating some of the purity of the neutrality standpoint and not talking about how two rather large bars in there are subject to a different set of considerations under heading two.
Because you never had, not only did you never have pure neutrality, but really, as a public policy, you don't really even want it. You know, you sort of want to favor some things.
I think there's something to that, but I think I would rather start with the presumption of neutrality, because I think the favor things is less likely to be, you know, David Kamin telling us what to favor, and more likely, you know, competing lobbyists deciding what to favor, or just even purely accidents and interactions telling us what to favor. So I'd rather start with the humility of, I think everything's equal. Then if we have a really strong reason, and I gave some strong reasons in some areas like research and areas like wind, deviate from that. But I'd still, maybe we get to the same place, but I'd do it neutrality, then externality, not just start there.
I'm Andreas Andrews, a student at the graduate tax program here. So I think a big principle today is talking about neutrality a lot. And so it would seem to suggest that maybe moving towards a business tax integration where all businesses are taxed in one way, as opposed to having a pass-through system and a corporate tax system with a lower rate, would be beneficial. And it seemed like you were talking about changing the structure of the pass-through, but what about changing all the businesses to be taxed like pass-throughs? Would that increase investment in U.S. companies and maybe even the quality as well?
Right. I mean, having them taxed as pass-throughs is in effect having a corporate rate of zero, which runs us into all the problems that I described in terms of, you know, one, sheltering income within a corporate form, and two, the deficiencies of the taxation of that income at the individual level. So I just think that, you know, broadly speaking, wouldn't be workable.
Hi, Patty Cohen. You mentioned that you thought the accelerated depreciation was very effective, but I think there was a recent article in the Harvard Business Review that said companies look like they were basically buying back shares as a way to keep their stock prices up, and was making the argument that the accelerated depreciation really did not spur more investment. And I was wondering if you saw that or...
I haven't seen that. You're sure it was accelerated depreciation? It wasn't the repatriation holiday in 2004, where that certainly was the case and it was very enormously ineffective?
But I don't have the article in front of me.
So let me answer the question you didn't ask and then I'll get to the one you did ask. I certainly think if you look at things like one-time repatriation holidays where you let companies bring money back from overseas and not get taxed on it, the evidence there was mostly that did lead to share buybacks. It led to a large cost to the Treasury because a lot of that money led to people keeping more money overseas after it. And it's the type of one-time tax change we shouldn't be doing in the tax system because it's destabilizing. I haven't seen the Harvard Business Review on investment. I'd note at a superficial level, investment growth in this expansion has been at a faster pace than the last one and a faster pace than the previous three on average. And then I'd say the best academic research, and the paper hasn't been published yet, is Eric Zwick at Chicago and James Mahan at Harvard. And they really carefully compare investments in, for example, different assets, one of which got it and one of which didn't, or a business that's cash constrained to one that's not. And they found very large effects. And those large effects were consistent with the intuition that I was giving, that there was a pretty big cash flow effect. That logic, though, is not operative, or at least is not operative to anywhere close to the same degree in 2014. So I think it's important that that's an argument about history, and that's an argument about, you know, what we need to do the next time we have a recession associated with significant financial constraints. You know, not something that I would use as an argument to continue it now. But I'll take a look at the Harvard Business Review and see what they said.
So, Jason, a question for ask a question. So, how big an effect do you think all of this is? So, we're talking about business tax reform. You started off by talking about total factor productivity, and like on the scale of thing, you were showing like the differences in total factor productivity over time. Do you think this is going to be so? This will really move the needle on total factor productivity, and to what degree? And to the extent, do you think this isn't the biggest deal, or like, what are the things that are big deals and like and the government should be pursuing to try to move total factor productivity?
So, no, is this, you know, half a tenth, one tenth, two tenths, three tenths? You know, numbers in those magnitudes seem to me plausible. When you look at the variations in TFP, the difference between, you know, the golden era and the era of despair was 1.2 or 1.3, I can't see it, in terms of TFP. So I think that's meaningful. I think that accumulates to something that's a decent size over time. And I also don't think it trades off against something. I don't think you're going to take accelerated depreciation and use it to pay for something that's even better for TFP than this. You're going to use it for this, or you're going to use it for nothing. So I don't think there's a trade-off. In fact, I think it can to some degree be complementary to other things we can do. You know, I think immigration reform, one of the things that's really exciting about it is CBO did an analysis of the Senate framework, and they found not just would it bring in, you know, an increased quantity of labor, but it also would result in higher total factor productivity, which they ascribe to the higher rates of patenting and entrepreneurship and business starting by immigrants. I also put some weight on just greater certainty for the people that are here, leading them to be able to invest more in education or in businesses. And, you know, education, trade, everything. But I think, you know, most of our public policies, if you measure them in terms of TFP and you measure them in terms of growth rates, not levels, are, you know, half of a tenth or a tenth. And, you know, a couple tenths accumulate that over time, and you're starting to talk about a meaningful difference.
Well, I wanted to thank Jason for coming tonight, and it's been a great pleasure to have you to talk about business tax reform.
And immigration.
And immigration.
And just on behalf of NYU and the graduate tax program, as you continue to think about business tax reform, we have an NYU tax hat for you, limited edition, which I think matches your suit. So.
And thank you all for coming. Thank you.